And when we look at stage two, of course, we're transitioning through stage two, very high birth rates, but dramatically decreasing death rates. What's going on there in terms of decreasing death rates is the first agriculture revolution is starting to kick in gear. And so with the first agriculture revolution, no more people dying of famine and hunger and starvation because we're producing more agriculture, we're producing more food than we ever have beforehand. Further, one of the characteristics of the first agriculture revolution is we start to have social levels, social stratification. So you got people at the top, middle, and bottom. So what that means is people at the top and middle have a little bit more access to a variety of diets, especially when you get globalization kicking in gear. And so, you know, you get your fruits, your veggies, your tropical stuff with the grains. And so you get more of a diverse diet, more of your food pyramid as far as being checked off the list. So you're essentially living healthier as incomes also increase. And so you can see a lot of this also relates to the economics, which of course we'll talk about in a future chapter. So also what you got going on here is think about stage two, typically are more lower income countries today. So these are places where water sanitation, unsafe sex is at higher levels, poor sanitation, poor water, just in general. Also, you got air pollution can be quite a big problem in some places. So stage two countries also have still, though, more people dying from infectious diseases than stage three and stage four countries. And so we can see transitioning occurring. So what we see is infectious disease being the key to understanding how people die in stage one and stage two countries. But when we transition to stage three and stage four, we're going to see those non-infectious diseases making a much larger role. So what's the most important thing that causes change from stage two to stage three in the epidemiologic transition model? Improvements in sanitation. So essentially the provision of clean water and sanitary facilities to remove your wastes and to make sure the wastes don't get into the water, which is very clever. The cartographer here made unsanitary areas brown. But anyway, so when we look at that transition, improved sanitation is the absolutely most important driver for this transition from infectious to non-infectious diseases. And this is in the United States, this is in Africa, this is in Europe, this is across the world. And another map that now looks at the proportion of the population using improved drinking water sources, and we can see red and yellow, that mustardy color, are places that have lower percentages. So when we look at a lot of mission work, a lot of Christian churches, for example, in the United States, they'll have missionaries who will go to Africa, and then one of the biggest things they do is just provide clean water. So something that is very, we take for granted in many respects, is very critical to improving the infectious disease rates in a lot of these countries and regions of the world. Now let's look at income level. And look at some different patterns. And so this is looking at infant mortality rates. And so stage one, especially stage two countries, keep in mind, no countries in the world are stage one today, but stage two countries, early stage three countries, are where we're going to find the highest rates of infant mortality. So essentially, low income, also we can think of as being stage two. And as we progress through the transition model, we eventually get to high income countries, which are stage four. More of that to follow in a future chapter. But what we see here is a couple of different patterns. Of course, infant mortality rates are higher in lower income countries or stage two countries. But what's happening is, where's the change, though, in terms of improvements in infant mortality rates and in terms of reducing them, we could say is in those low income countries. Now, a lot of that is because they have such high numbers, they have a long way to fall. Compared to high-income countries, but nonetheless, we do see optimism. So when we look at a lot of the population pyramids in these low-income countries, one of the kind of the things that's happening is the base of the pyramid is getting wider and wider and wider. And what's happening is babies are actually making it and surviving, but birth rates still remain high. And so you have even more of a younger population as medical advancements, technologies, and awareness improves. And it's which then relates to improvements in infant mortality rates. Now that we're in the stage three of the epidemiologic transition model, which once again relates to the demographic transition model, we see decreasing infectious disease as far as how people die and more of those non-infectious diseases. a lot of this is related to just improvements in life expectancy, and so a continued decrease in the crude death rate. So what that means is essentially people are living longer, people more likely to move to urban areas, so we see the kind of air pollution that might become more of a burden. You also have more people have extra income, extra money. When you have extra money, you might spend it on booze, on cigarettes, and so, you know, obviously lung cancer, cirrhosis of the liver are more likely to be ailments in this stage as you increase wealth. But the biggest thing is people are fighting off those infectious diseases via improvements in medical awareness, technology, what have you, with the big one being vaccinations. Now here's an old chart here that shows just different diseases, different infectious diseases in the United States and kind of their decline. And this is essentially what the moral of the story is. This is how your grandparents and your great-great-grandparents and all of them, this is how they died. They died from these various things, and now we get shots for, hopefully, we get vaccinations and we never get, and they don't become too much of a burden. Finally, we have our stage four countries, in which we have continued extensions of lifespans, people living longer. Infectious diseases are very rare. You might see, for example, on IUPUI's campus, they've had mumps. They've had tuberculosis recently. Those are infectious diseases. But for the most part, non-infectious diseases explain stage four countries as far as how people die. And so we look at transitions happening. You know, some would say China is transitioning to stage four. So one of the things they're seeing now in China is something we have in the United States, increasing obesity. So a lot of that's related to our diet, diets that have higher levels of fat, also decreasing physical activity. Combine those two things together, of course, we're going to have increasing obesity rates. And this is at all age groups. So especially childhood obesity is becoming a bigger global issue, especially as more countries transition through this model. So we look at diabetes, for example, would be also something that you're seeing on the rise because more countries are transitioning through this particular model and then subsequently having higher levels of obesity, also not eating as good of diets, but you know, a lot of that's related to advancements in technology. I mean, it's easier to get that crappy, bad-for-you food from anywhere in the world to you here in the middle of nowhere, Indiana. Now let's see some evidence of this transition model. So we have our case study countries in the DTM stages. We've already identified them from a previous chapter. And when we look at communicable deaths, definitely we see that pattern. More people die per 100,000 persons. More people die in stage two and stage three countries from communicable or infectious diseases, which we can also then see on a map. And so a lot of those case study countries, those regions in which we see continued evidence of stage two, stage three characteristics, we can see also have higher rates in this case of TB deaths, tuberculosis deaths from people who have HIV. So infectious diseases, we can see, once again, some regional, some very geographic patterns. More evidence, cholera. Recent outbreaks from 2010 to 2013, the areas colored there in orange are where we see these particular patterns. In higher levels, and once again, also tend to be a lot of our stage two countries of the world. Now we have another pattern, and that's the fact that, man, these people in stage two, stage three countries, they also have higher levels of non-communicable deaths. So they just have more deaths in general. Now, there's some things going on there, but what we really want to focus in on is down at the bottom, looking at the stage four countries. Here you can see a proportion of the overall ways in which people die much higher there in terms of non-communicable or non-infectious diseases. And so we really need to think about these numbers in proportion to each other, which I do now in this far right-hand column. So this says this is the proportion of non-communicable versus communicable deaths. And so you can see a much higher percentage in stage four countries of non-communicable deaths than those stage two, stage three countries. So I just used the colors to further emphasize that. So once again, this shows evidence of the epidemiological transition model. Simple bar graph showing in 2010 the 10 leading causes of death in the United States. And we can see from this list, most of the ones there at the top, the biggest ones, the biggest bars, are non-communicable diseases. Now, interestingly, in a lot of wealthier countries, richer countries of the world, you do see lower rates of people smoking, or shall I say decreasing rates of smoking. So essentially, people are smoking less. You're really seeing this in the United States from the younger population, young college students, 18 to say 35-year-olds, much lower rates of cigarette smoking. And so what that means is, though, those who have been smoking for the last 30, 40 years in the United States, you know, that's since the 1950s, large numbers of people were smoking. Lung cancer has now become the top killer for women in, it's to say, in general in stage four countries. And so what's happening now, once again, like I said, the transition. So a lot of countries in the world, they're transitioning through their model. Now you're seeing increasing rates of tobacco usage, which makes the tobacco companies really, really happy. While tobacco might be decreasing in the United States, they're finding new markets, and they're finding new markets in a lot of those developing countries, those stage three countries. And so what's seeing now is more rates of lung cancers in a lot of places that previously I didn't have those high rates, where people died, more, once again, more from infectious diseases. And of course, this can be mapped. And so you see Southeast Asia, China, great examples, parts of Latin America, places that have really high percentage of tobacco use amongst adults, even though they're not what we would think of as stage four countries. Definitely stage three countries, though. China, for sure. Indonesia, for sure. Argentina, Chile, yada, yada. So what we can see here, though, is in Europe, especially there in Eastern Europe, very high percentage of tobacco use among adults. So subsequently, high rates of lung cancer in those areas. Go figure. Guess what you also find in those areas? Higher rates of alcohol use, and then subsequently, liver failure and cirrhosis of the liver and all kinds of things related to alcoholism. So we can see some patterns. So finally, we could say, wow, Africa and Middle East and parts of Asia finally have something good to talk about. The fact that you don't see high cigarette usage, high alcohol usage at the moment. So that's, once again, as places transition, you know, will their behavior transition? So far, it's been fairly predictable. Once again, you transition, you get a little bit extra wealth, you start buying, you know, these vices, alcohol, cigarettes, tobacco, what have you. So this is, once again, we can relate this map, we can see it right now, 2012, but we can understand changes over time, transitions over time and place. And then continuing this cancer mortality, once again, same overlapping patterns. So if we could identify on a map, these are, once again, going to be more of our stage four, late stage three countries. Fittingly, I'm going to end this discussion here on Epidemiologic Transition Model, this video, by talking about the end of life, and so this life expectancy. And so here's different data that's interesting patterns that are revealed. First off, we can see our lower income countries, our stage two countries. One of the things is there have been major improvements in life expectancy. Now, some would say that it's because they have so much improvement potential in the terms of life expectancies were so low, they could only go high. But what's really happening there, once again, is the transition. You're seeing evidence of this transition. So as you increase wealth, there's improvements in life expectancy. Medical awareness, technology is advancing. Science is advancing. However, its impact as far as increasing life expectancy isn't as profound there as you would find in stage two countries. Finally, when we look at gender, some interesting patterns are also revealed. We look at stage two countries on the left. We also refer to them as lower-income countries, and high-income countries on the right. We also refer to those as stage four countries. And so what this shows is the difference between the average life expectancy of a woman versus a man is not that different at all in stage two countries, but pretty noticeable difference in stage four countries. Now, the moral of the story is all throughout the world, women outlive men. So that's definitely something we see. But the idea here is as countries and regions transition over time, as they become more like high-income countries, women increasingly outlive men. And so what this shows is in high-income countries in 2012, women were outliving men by 6.2 years, whereas in low-income countries, it was only 2.9 years. And so what that means is essentially in as you transition, women increasingly outlive their male counterparts.